From Stockholm, Sweden, I'm presenting myself, Peter Geilinger, your host, featuring guests from around the world in interesting conversations and stories. Eva-Maria Westbrook is one of the world's leading sopranos. She's basically everywhere. Actually, she doesn't need an introduction. Her singing and stage presence has brought her to top opera houses on every continent. I wonder how she deals with her success and what drives her to perfection. And I'm very fortunate to have this conversation. Eva, what?
Eva, no one, I love how you say Eva.
Yeah, my Swedish accent, yes. I'm thinking of you every time I'm talking English nowadays.
Really?
Yeah, it's the diphthongs, I guess. What are you doing now? What's your next production?
I just did something which was so nice, and we did a streaming thing of Kurt Weill's Seven Deadly Sins, and it was really fun with an amazing director, and very artsy, and with a fantastic actress who I learned so much from. And with orchestra, it was amazing to do something, to have rehearsals, to get up in the morning and go and work and see people and not be alone at home. And although I'm with Frank, so I'm not alone, but it's amazing. And now I'm free, and we started teaching a bit. So we're doing a lot of teaching, poor students, and it's fun. I'm having a lot of fun. And then I'm supposed to go to Berlin. I was supposed to sing Wozzeck, but they changed it to Ariadne, but nobody knows. So I don't know. I don't know if it's going to happen in May.
Interesting. Were people more friendly during the rehearsals after this the shutdown of the pandemic, or was it as usual?
Because it was a fun, it was a group of a lovely group of people, and we had started rehearsal. We were going to do a production of it, and then the pandemic came and we had to stop. So we were all very much sad and everything. And then now we did it, and we changed the whole concept and made it all for like a video, like a documentary almost. And the cameraman was part of the production. He was running after us, and the lightning was like, you know, it was all very, and we were just, it was fun. It was really fun. And everybody was so happy to be working. Everybody was super nervous too, because you've lost this ability to deal with these amounts of adrenaline that we always deal with. And I was always like on this super high adrenaline, like going and going and going. And then when you stop, it's like you fall very deep. And I it was great because I sort of relaxed finally after a long time. And it helped me, but now to perform again, it's so much adrenaline. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yes. Isn't it important to relax sometimes and recover? I mean, this pandemic closed down many opera houses, and singers were suddenly in a different situation. This is also, I mean, a chance to relax and recover.
Yeah, it's something, because you always are in stress, basically. But to be honest, I've done, I was lucky in a way to be singing so much, but also because I love it so much, and then you say yes to everything, so I didn't have weeks free. I never almost had weeks free, and then it almost killed me. And then at a certain point, I said, you know, and I took like a month. And it was amazing. And we were just in nature, you know, nothing and no stress. Oh my God. And then you recharge. Yeah, it's strange. I don't remember how I did it. I don't know how I recharge. I didn't recharge enough, I think. I think singers, well, I think I had a therapist or something, like a performance coach, and she said also, you know, you have to think more like an athlete, that you do something and then you need to take a break, or you have to have your rest periods. And when we do like a big role, I don't know how you feel about this, but you know, I did some very heavy productions, and then you're rehearsing every day, weeks, and it's super heavy, and you get more tired and tired, and then the big rehearsals come with orchestra, and then it's really important, and then you can't. And I found that you know, when you're, I don't know, it got me in the end. But so the corona put me to a halt, which for me was quite healthy, actually. I mean, it was, of course, shit. You had great projects that were not happening, but I think it was quite good for my body and mind. But now to start again, I need to get used to all the adrenaline. My God, yeah.
For how long in advance have you planned your productions?
I think for me it's now 3 years in advance. That's it.
Yeah.
And you started to teach, or you have been teaching for many years?
I did a masterclass once in a school, and this one girl called me and said, would you please teach me again? But I was always on the road, so I said, I can't. So Frank taught her a bit, and now I taught her then too, and I really loved it. She's very special. And we said, shall we do a masterclass? And she said, yes, I'll organize it. And she got all her friends. And we have a nice big house, and we have upstairs we can sing. We all bought Corona tests because Frank was in Germany. And they all came, 7 people. And Frank's son is a cook. So he's a chef. So he cooked all these amazing meals and lunches. And we sang all day with these young, fantastic singers. Yeah, it was really fun. Such high voices, my God. Queen of the night, too. I mean, what am I going to say? Please teach me how to do it. I can't do that. Yeah. But
you learn the whole life to sing, I guess. You find new things, and
I find it fascinating.
Yeah, it is. It is. That's, we don't stop learning, I guess.
No, this is a part of it, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it is. I remember when we were in Germany, and I saw you. We were in Saturn or something, and then you were looking at recordings, and you picked up a CD with Eva Cassidy.
Because you told me to, yeah.
Did I say that?
Yes, you said you have to listen to her.
Oh, did you listen to it then? I don't know.
Of course, it's beautiful, so pure.
Oh, did I?
Yeah, you told me. Listen to Eva Cassidy.
Okay, yeah. She...
Where was this? Because we met up in another city. We met up.
That was in Munich.
Munich.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Trimbon is dead.
Oh.
Dead.
Kleiber is dead. They were friends. They were best friends, Kleiber and Trimbon.
Yeah.
I think when I look at all videos with Kleiber, you know, rehearsal videos, I think he was amazing as an artist.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We were so lucky to meet Trimbon and work with him. Yeah, it was such, what a man.
Yeah.
An inspiration, and what fun and what joy and fire and passion. He, in every single note, he had 5,000 books to say of what to do with that note. It was amazing. Yeah. I loved him.
If you would go back 20 years from now, would you have done anything differently?
I had some good times and some bad times and all that stuff, but the good times were great, and I had such dreams, big dreams come true that I will never. So whatever it was, I'm happy, you know. And and the bad things taught me stuff, and so I had, you know, such beautiful experiences. I don't know what I would have done different. Maybe take better care of my charging. But then, you know, my enthusiasm, and it brought me my adrenaline. It was all worth it, I think, for the good thing.
Is there any particular production that you are more proud of?
Oh, yeah. Well, I had a couple of things, a couple of such sensational dreams come true. Like when I was a young singer, my favorite singer has always been Renata Tebaldi. So I would put her singing on and fall asleep and dream, you know, I want to sing this voice. And still, when I hear her voice, I start crying. I love it so much. Talking about her makes me want to cry. So, and my favorite opera was always La Fanciulla del West. And when I was young, when I would be down, I would watch the video. I had a video of Carol Neblett and Domingo. She was amazing as well, in Covent Garden, in this production. And then I got the chance to sing for Tony Papano, and I sang for him. And I remember that I sang only German because my agent had told me no one will want to hear you in Italian. And my only dream was to be Tebaldi and sing only Italian. So I was a bit like this, and I sang only German. And Papano said, why don't you sing Italian? And I said, whoa, do you want to hear my Italian? He said, of course. He said, come on, Visi d'arte, you know? And he put it on the piano. He didn't even know. He did it by heart. And I said, but I didn't prepare. And said, come on, you know it. And I had sung it. And so I sang Visi d'arte, and I cracked. I cracked the last. I said, oh my God, I'm cracking. And he said, I don't care, you know? And then after this, I didn't hear anything for a long time, but they offered me for this audition. It's like a dream. They offered me three things. Lady Macbeth of Matensk, Sieglinde. And then they called me later and said, my agent said, yeah, they want to do this funny opera that you might have heard of, and they want to do it with you, La Fanciulla del West. And I said, really? And in that old production. And this was like stepping into my favorite child movie, you know, like stepping into Little House on the Prairie. I knew the tables. I knew my dress. I knew, and we even had the same baritone from then, you know. He was a bit older, but he was still amazing. And oh my God, I can't believe it was the most amazing experience to just do your dream. So I felt so lucky, and it was such a great, and the director was amazing, and what a time. And this opera is just one of the best operas ever written. So exciting. It's so wonderful and loving, and her character has all the facets, and she's so real. It was amazing. That was one of the highlights of my life. And then another one was singing an opera that was written, and I created the role, so I was the first, and it was Anna Nicole Smith, and that was one of the most wonderful experiences also of my life, to be part of such a creative thing, to be in the same room as the composer and the librettist, and to do this music, which was such good music, such good words, and it was such a brilliant opera. And it was mental. I mean, I had to have tremendous boobs and be very blonde. I remember I had rehearsal boobs because they had to be so big. So I wore cotton, you know, how you call it, where you clean your face with. And they put it in there, and everybody said, please, can I touch them? So everybody in the morning would go, touch my fake boob. I don't know. I've never had more friends in my life than when I had blonde hair and very big boobs. but also the whole project and the whole thing. I was amazed. And my first Sieglinde was Simon Rattle. Sorry, I had such fantastic experiences to work with the Simon Rattle and the Berlin Phil, and to sing Sieglinde and in a beautiful production. It was just such an experience to hear that orchestra. And oh my God, I can't tell you. It was, I was just so blessed and lucky to do all that.
To the question of why is opera such a great form of art, then you said, well, it's so many people involved and everybody contributes.
Yeah, and when it's on, when something works and everybody is in the same groove and all the energy and all the focus is on the same, in the same moment, and everybody's in it, it can be transformational. It's transformational to do it. That's why I'm so addicted to it, because it can be so amazing, but also for the audience, I think.
When did you decide to be an opera singer?
When I was 16. Okay. So I wanted to be a ballerina, but that I had no talent whatsoever. So that was short-lived. And then I just wanted to sing, and actually I wanted to sing jazz and all that sort of stuff. But I had a really lovely teacher, fantastic woman, and she said we did some exercises, and I remember one moment just woo, you know, this voice came out. Do you remember that too? Did you have that too? Oh, it was weird, because I was like and woo, you know, all of a sudden, okay, this head voice thing, and I was like you know, and then she said, oh, you have to be an opera singer. She said it immediately, and she gave me a record of Traviata, which of course I never sang, but with Sutherland and Pavarotti, and that was it for me. I thought, this is it, it was like lightning. Yeah, so then I wanted to be a singer no matter what.
Isn't it nice to be someone else as well on the stage?
Oh, it's best, it's fantastic, it's the best. Yeah, oh, and I love, you know, I did a production of Lady Macbeth of Matensk, and we were all, there was this whole, the whole stage was mud in the first act, and in the second, well, for, we were in a little house, and we had to step into the mud, and in the last act, it was all water, and for some reason, to have this physical, it does something to you, to be on a stage, and to wear certain costumes and a wig, you become somebody else, and there in the mud, and we all became dirty, and in the water, it was cold, and you know, it does something to your, it helps. It was brilliant. Yeah, I love that.
When you travel, do you bring many of your personal items with you, or do you go back and forth to your house, or how you could be many days abroad, I guess?
Yeah, I've been doing.
You have a dog.
I had Ruby, and she traveled with me all the time, and she was such a good companion. You know, I took her everywhere. She was in all the theaters. I would sneak her in a bag and put her in the dressing room, and everybody loved her. All the dressers and makeup people, and she was just so sweet. And she was like my anchor, you know. And I would sometimes not bring her when I was doing rehearsal, because then you don't have enough time. But during a string of performances, and every day you can go to a park and go to a forest, or, you know, just to have her run. And it's wonderful. So I used to bring her all the time. And now she passed away, unfortunately. And I have a new puppy now. And she's already 2.5. And she's amazing, but she's a little taller. We didn't know. We got the same breed. So I was already bummed on a flight. I couldn't get on the plane because they said, no, she's too tall for the flight. So I was like, so it's more complicated. And then Corona happened. So I brought her sometimes, but not as much. But she's also very good. She's lovely. She's very different. She's more of a hunter dog.
So that's your family.
That's my family. Yes. Yeah, she's my family. Yeah.
Frank is also singing a lot.
Yeah, he was, and of course now we both came to a standstill. But he was singing. He was a long time in Frankfurt in the opera house there, And he was, you know, also freelancing and singing here and there and everywhere. And so and sometimes we sang together, which was, that was really, really nice. We even went to Japan together and to South America, to Chile. That was so amazing to be in Santiago. I love it there. And we went to Dresden. We were together. And he came to the one day I sang in the Met. I sang Valkyrie, and he'd never been to America. And he finally had time to come and see it because he couldn't come the first time. And so he came, and he had a holiday, and he was tired, and he already had his cigar. Sometimes he smokes a cigar, and he said, I'm going to smoke a nice cigar in New York. And then we had lunch, and the next day was with my manager, and the next day was the afternoon show. And the manager looked at him and said, how do you feel, Frank? And Frank said, I'm not singing. And Alan Green said, I think you might be. So he came, and he hadn't sung Siegmund for so long. And they said, Jonas Kaufmann can't sing. The cover is sick too. Can you please save the performance? And he did. It was so stressful, I can't tell you. And I went early to the theater. I said, please don't tell him it's on radio. And they said, so what are we going to do with his mic? And I was like, shit, you know, it was live on the radio too. Super stressful. But he made it through, and we were like, oh, you know, we sang together in New York even. And then later he also sang in Lady Macbeth that I did there. He sang a show. He was the cover, and he sang one performance of Sergei. And that was really fun. We were there on stage together. Where I'm sitting. So I'm sitting in the library, which is his record collection.
Wow. Yeah.
And it goes on.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's cool.
And then you haven't seen that part yet. And that's his passion, you know?
Oh, yes. I knew that. I knew that.
Yeah. So every city, he knows the secondhand store for records. So, yeah. And this is nothing, just a third of what he has. Because downstairs is more, and he loves it.
Yeah, but what about conductors that don't take any notice of to the singers in the tempo or the subtexts?
We're not like a piano where you just go, and every body is different. Everybody's different, but every physical apparatus is different. And some people can do it quick, and some can do it slow. And if you don't want to adapt to this, then you're just an asshole. You know, and you shouldn't be a conductor of singers, because this is the beauty of singing, is the diversity of people. And you have to love this about singers, because you can make, I sang with James Levine. I was so blessed to be singing with that man. What a man. And he did that like nobody else. And it was the end of his life already, and he was already quite sick. But he gave you wings, this man. He would be there for you, would help you. And still, in the end, you would do what he wanted. But with a very beautiful way, he would help you, and he would guide you and carry you and make you feel like you were, you know. And this was sensational, you know.
Yeah.
That's what conductors, they should have respect for the human voice and study singing. And this is something, sometimes I say to friends, I say, I would like to give this person a singing lesson. So they realize what it means to take a breath, and what it means to sing a line, and what it means to how long a line is, you know. Just this lack of respect sometimes is staggering.
Yeah, we sang together in Stuttgart, and not long ago you went back. How was it this time?
It was amazing to be back. It was amazing to be back, and it was also weird. because I was, it was long ago, and I felt so old all of a sudden. and it was a different time, and it will never be like it was. And I had a brilliant time there. I know you sometimes were so missing your family, which must have been super difficult. But yeah. And I was very lonely too sometimes, to be honest. But I loved the theater and I loved our work. And
oh, yeah, it has been such a pleasure to have this great conversation. And time just flies very quickly when you're having fun. I wish you all the best. And unfortunately, we have to end this lovely conversation. I give my best regards to Frank and your lovely dog, and hope to see you sometime in the near future.
Okay, Peter. Peter.
Bye.
Thank you so much. It was lovely to speak to you.
Yeah. See you. Bye.
Okay, hey. Bye. I don't know how to pronounce this. End. Okay.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.